this could be me.
Acclaim Entertainment are bringing us the greatest legends of wrestling together for the first time in one place. Forget about The Rock and Stone Cold Steve Austin. Here we're harking back to the American grapplers who made wrestling great.
Like all the fun turns into shame.
Over 20 of the best wrestlers of all time compete in over 12 different match types. You can get to grips with the likes of Bret the Hitman Hart, Jerry the King Lawler, Jake the Snake Roberts, Jimmy Superfly Snuka, and George the Animal Steele. There's also in-depth match analysis and career guidance provided by Bobby the Brain Heenan and Captain Lou Albano. The action takes place both in the ring and in the crowd, with plenty of diverse moves and fighter interaction. You can even create your own wrestlers and add logos and text to their costumes. A game worth getting a lock on. Run Like Hell is the upcoming third-person sci-fi horror survival adventure from Digital Mayhem. You play the part of Captain Nick Connor, who just happens to be posted to the Forseti station when aliens attack, killing most of the crew. And these aliens learn from your actions as well, becoming more intelligent as the game goes on. Digital Mayhem promises us an intense storyline, spanning seven gripping chapters of action-packed gameplay, with a powerful game engine bringing to life the characters, objects and environments in full 3D. One of the big attractions is the impressive lineup of voice talent boasted by the game. You can expect to hear the unmistakable tones of Lance Henriksen, Kate Mulgrew and Clancy Brown, along with many more. Sounds good to us. ESPN International Winter Sports 2002 is the latest update from Konami. But what can we expect to see here?
The screen time was 1:04.87. The Britain just completed their run.
There are 10 amazing events for you to ice, including downhill alpine skiing, slalom skiing, bobsleigh, snowboarding, ski jumping, freestyle mogul skiing, speed skating, figure skating, and curling. The two modes on offer are Trial Mode, which allows you to master any of the events you choose, or Championship Mode, where you take up the flag of your given country and play through all the events in order. 8 countries are represented. The US, Japan, England, France, Germany, Italy, Canada and Holland. And each with differing performance characteristics and abilities. So the choice is not just aesthetic. Roll in a two-player split-screen mode and crisp, clean graphics, and things are definitely looking cool. Godai Elemental Force follows the story of Hiro, heir to the throne and guardian of the elemental spirit. His parents and mentor have been killed by Akunin, leader of the Dark Ninjas, and now he must complete the trials of the elements. Only then will he be ready to face the powers of darkness in the realm of the final element. The void awaits. Godai promises to feature 16 levels of exciting action-packed adventure, set through the trials of the four spirit elements, earth, wind, water and fire.
Ignited by fire!
To make this possible, you have a varied arsenal of oriental and mystical weapons, including katana, twin blades, throwing spikes, shuriken, smoke bombs, and elemental magic.
Oh, he's too good!
You know it.
Besides the single-player campaign, you'll also have 7 two-player game modes to pit your skills against. And with 3DO promising that the control system will be simple enough for anyone to simply pick up and play, there should be no problem finding challenging opponents. Endgame from Empire Interactive is the exciting new excuse to work out your trusty PlayStation 2 light gun. And what you're seeing here is some of the early code that will evolve into a glorious new gun fest. For those who need it, there's a sophisticated plot involving a story set in both the real world and a strange new virtual world. You play Jade, a 25-year-old American woman whose English boyfriend Tyler has been kidnapped by Eurodream Technologies, the creators of the virtual world used every day by the masses. Despite Tyler's obvious inability to look after himself, Jade sets out to rescue him in an adventure that takes her through 16 real-world levels set all across Europe and beyond. The meat of the game consists of facing down sophisticated artificially intelligent opponents that provide difficult and constantly shifting challenges. And you thought it was just another shooting game. Activision's latest Spider-Man release follows the plot of the upcoming movie, but with an emphasis on the action. Check out the variety of web-slinging tricks at your command, including the new yo-yo move, hanging from the ceiling, and the chance for some aerial combat. Spidey gets down and dirty with kicks, punches, suplexes, and even sitting on people's shoulders and pummeling their heads. Confront old favourites like the Shocker and Scorpion, along with classic villains making their debut in the video game format, the Vulture and the Green Goblin. The graphics are swish and true to that Spider-Man feel. Bound into the world of cartoon action with the craziest woodpecker known to man, Woody the Woodpecker. This madcap 3D adventure is the product of Dreamcatcher Interactive and tries to remain as true to the TV cartoons as possible. Woody's dastardly archenemy, Buzz Buzzard, has captured Woody's niece and nephew, Splinter and Knothead, within the deadly rides of his sinister theme park, Buzz Buzzard Park. And it's up to this heroic woodpecker to rescue the hapless half-pints from the vile vulture's evil clutches. The controls are simple and allow you to jump, duck, peck and surf your way through the many challenging obstacle courses as Woody competes with the various devilish rides around the park. You get to play with all three of the main characters as they romp about the numerous colourful environments. There are more than 30 levels to fool about in, and all of the scenery and action is designed to be in keeping with the actual cartoons. Even the problem-solving demonstrates a strong leaning towards cartoon logic. Frontline puts you back in the shoes of Jimmy Patterson, hero of previous Medal of Honor titles. He's working with the OSS and now has to use different battle tactics to reach his new objective, stealing an experimental weapon that could very well turn the tide of war. By securing the devastatingly powerful top-secret flying wing, Patterson and his crew may save hundreds, even thousands of lives.
Sullivan, James P.
And Mike Wazowski.
Monsters, Inc. is an action-adventure carrying the Disney and Pixar endorsements, set prior to the movie of the same name. So what's it all about? Monsters, Inc. is an organization dedicated to collecting screams from children. These screams are needed to power the monster's world. But not just any monster can join this elite operation. First they must graduate from the training program, and this is where we join the action. Mike, the walking eyeball thing, and Sully, the blue yeti, are training to become top scarers. You can switch from one to the other in order to solve the various challenges as you progress through the island training resort. You'll need to make your way through a variety of regions, including deserts, jungles, and mountains, and be sure to scare the robotic children, dogs, and the strange creatures called nerves. As you progress through the game, you learn new and more impressive scare tactics until you've collected all 18 and graduate to become full employees of Monsters, Inc.
Race is about to go green.
EA Sports is bringing its stock car racing title up to date with a completely overhauled graphics engine, and as you can see, it's looking pretty good for it. You can also expect to find every NASCAR star, rookie and veteran, including such names as Tony Stewart, Jeff Gordon, Dale Jarrett, Bobby Labonte, Rusty Wallace, Jeff Burton, Bill Elliott, Michael Waltrip and Dale Earnhardt Jr. With four car manufacturers, 23 tracks, and all the usual game modes from quick races to full career simulations, NASCAR racing has never looked so good. Getaway is an uncompromising action thriller combining reckless driving action with foot combat and vast levels of cinematic storyline. There is a huge living, breathing environment with more than 40 square kilometres of London backstreets and 20 interior real-life locations, all immaculately rendered and riddled with underworld characters. Sony's E3 press conference held one big surprise, and that was the short trailer for the upcoming Resident Evil Online. Making an appearance earlier than expected, there was the chance to see some of the impressive visuals and four-way split screen. But for the game to look this good at such an early stage of its development can only be a good sign of what's to come. James Bond is back in action once more in 007 Nightfire, fighting to defeat the world-dominating schemes of the evil criminal mastermind, Raphael Drake. But despite the fancy settings, the gameplay remains true to the Bond universe. And there's even a split-screen multiplayer mode for up to four players. Lamborghini puts you behind the wheel of the legendary supercars, both past and present. You can take to the roads in a wide range of Lamborghini motors, including the 350 GT, Miura, Countach, Diablo, and the very latest supercar, Murcielago. Based on New Line Cinema's epic adaptation of J.R.R. Tolkien's classic fantasy novels, The Lord of the Rings: The Two Towers from Electronic Arts allows you to relive the most memorable moments from the first two films. There are plenty of orcs and other monsters to battle past, along with powerful bosses such as the Cave Troll and Saruman the White. This is the real way MGS2 should be, its real substance. First up are over 200 VR missions, which are exactly what you'd expect if you played the add-on from the PS1 game. But perhaps more engaging are the alternative missions, set in locations from the main game, and thus benefiting from the extraordinary detailed world of MGS. Silent Hill 3 sees a return to the eerie survival horror series with even more stunning graphics, masterful use of sound, and mature, sophisticated storylines. Konami aren't giving much away at the moment, but they did offer these glimpses at E3, giving us a taste of the deeper and darker secrets waiting to be uncovered. The original Red Faction was fun, thanks to its enjoyably alien atmosphere and intriguing space vistas. But the revolutionary Geomod engine ended up as little more than a gimmick. And now Violation promises stealth, puzzle-solving and action-oriented objectives in the Earth-based sequel, Red Faction 2. Force has struck the Earth, and the harmony created by the dolphins and humans is in mortal danger. The Force ripped a hole in the fabric of reality, and one dolphin, Echo, has fallen through into the past. Echo's mission is to restore paradise and save the planet from self-destruction by recovering the stolen dolphin power, which has been scattered through time and space. However, the biggest obstacle for Echo to overcome is to avoid becoming completely blissed out by the tranquility of his surroundings. It's extremely relaxing just twisting, swooping, gliding, and leaping through the beautiful submarine world without even considering taking on any of the tasks set before you. You can speak to the other marine creatures by sending a burst of sonar at them, and it seems that most of them are up to something, and often in need of a hand. Help them out and you can receive help in return, such as saving a turtle from the sharks and being rewarded with a nice song to fight the sharks with in the future. As you progress through the variety of challenges, you'll learn to master all of Echo's moves to fight off the nastier sea creatures and use his vast IQ to solve the devious puzzles. For instance, trapping the great white shark in the corals using your shark song allows you to collect the power of vigor, which then allows you to complete that particular level. The creative team has benefited from the talents of award-winning science fiction author David Brin, and to keep things nicely chilled, frustration levels are minimized by quick restarts when things go wrong for you and your fishy friend. So, for the most laid-back experience you can get without resorting to controlled substances, immerse yourself in Echo's watery world.
Dolphins and humans had lived together in unity, harmony, and fellowship.
Echo the Dolphin's latest adventure, Defender of the Future, comes to PS2 via the Dreamcast. This aquatic adventure begins with a lengthy storytelling sequence in which it's revealed that a mysterious planet-threatening force, known as the Foe, is poised to pull the plug on Earth's inhabitants. The enormous 3D environments created for Echo to explore are simply incredible, each crammed with a vast array of superbly animated sea life. Echo himself is particularly impressive, jumping and splashing around with fluidity. Beyond Echo's basic abilities, which include the attacking high-speed nosebutt, sonar songs can be used to communicate and manipulate other creatures and are picked up as you progress throughout the adventure. Overall, this makes for one of the most relaxing and subliminally soothing game experiences ever. But frustratingly enough, it's plagued with the same annoyances inexplicably unchanged from the Dreamcast version. Impatient players will soon become irritated by the lack of direction, and the tasks themselves aren't particularly inspired. Some early levels can take hours to complete, while a few of the later missions can offer no more than 20 minutes of gameplay. You'll also find yourself retreading the same old ground several times over, not intentionally, but as a result of the difficulty in navigating the environments. This was possibly the biggest criticism aimed at the Dreamcast version, but it's been slightly improved for PS2 owners by the inclusion of a compass that points you in the general direction of your next task. The slightly unbalanced learning curve and lack of direction at times is the main gripe, but overall, Defender of the Future is beautifully crafted and entertaining through each of the 30 beautiful-looking levels on offer.
Destined to become the only hope for humans and dolphins. Echo, Defender of Earth's Future.
research center without security clearance.
I'm telling you, I heard gunshots.
Time Splitters was one of the most popular titles from the release of PS2, but it was hampered by a less than complete single player mode. Now developer Free Radical has had a chance to get to grips with the new technology, and Time Splitters 2 looks set to make up for all the shortcomings of its predecessor. Great attention has been lavished upon the single player mode, taking numerous leads from the hugely successful GoldenEye. The levels are layered, with each new difficulty level requiring you to achieve a whole new set of objectives.
The light. Stupid torch.
The actual story follows in the footsteps of the original game, but with its own distinct narrative. You can expect to encounter over 90 new characters, all portrayed in vivid detail, right down to details like teeth. You may come to recognise the maps, but all the characters and objects will have changed, and you'll need even more skill and judgement to make it through to the next stage. Each of them has a distinct personality. Some will be evasive, others will be cautious or aggressive, and expect their attacks to be tricky. They aren't all going to charge straight at you. To help you out, there's a vast selection of weapons available to you. And if that's not enough, then you can always take control of one of the sentry guns and give the enemy a taste of their own medicine. As you'll no doubt have noticed, the other benefit derived from Free Radical's exploration of the PS2 technology is the advanced graphics. We can now look forward to all manner of new visual treats, such as particle effects, fire, smoke, and fog. All of this adds to the already brilliant multiplayer game seen in the original. It's looking fantastic. We'll find out for sure in the new year. Creating a genre all of its own, Rez can best be described as Vibribbon meets Tron, and you still wouldn't have a clue what's going on. The background story has you fighting spores of a virus inside a female computer, but the game is so surreal that the plot is totally irrelevant. What you're actually doing is destroying enemies in time with the music. Each level throws 10 layers of enemies between you and the boss monster. To eliminate the enemies, you have a lock-on laser capable of 8 shots at a time, as well as a smart bomb that clears out everything, provided you charged it up. Each time you destroy a bad guy, you hear a sound, which, theory states, you're supposed to tie in with the music. You can also collect the blue power-ups to transform your hero into more advanced forms. But every time you take a hit, you devolve back down, until finally you pass through simple, geometric shapes and then vanish. The concept is simple, the graphics are primal and the music is hypnotizing, but the whole effect is strangely compelling. Definitely a game to be tried in the dark of night, when you can really let go of reality and get lost in the game. Res is one of those games that is completely uncategorizable. As a shooting game, it's utterly useless, but as an experience, it's something else. What exactly, we don't know, but definitely something else. The controls are basic in the extreme, with a movable targeting reticule, a fire button, and a second button that triggers the all-obliterating overdrive attack. Simple to play, but impossible to understand. The main concept involves you shooting things. Sometimes these things break up into other things that also require shooting, and sometimes they might break into things that you should collect. And each thing you destroy causes a particular sound, which a skilled shooter can theoretically cause to make some manner of tune in combination with the chilled out background music. However, the chances of anyone memorizing the noises and trying to play any sort of tune are pretty much zero. Of the pickups, probably the most important are the blue crystals. As you collect these, the white bar increases. When it fills up, your avatar upgrades to the next stage, beginning to look more humanoid. But you'll need to keep doing this because every time you're hit, you degrade a little, eventually devolving to a simple ball before disappearing entirely. The other handy collectibles are the red crystals. These items add to your overdrive bar. This comes in useful to wipe out everything in sight when it all becomes too much to bear. It's all very bizarre, hardly a game at all, more of a strange and mind-opening trip. As a shooting game, it's awful, but it can have a hypnotic power nonetheless. Whether it's worth your money or not really depends upon your tolerance for this kind of thing. Not everyone's taste, certainly, but mesmerizing to those who've played it for any length of time. Jimmy Whirlwind White returns to dazzle us once more with his Cockney charm, and the third in his classic snooker and pool games. You can expect to find state-of-the-art kinetics, which lead to a completely realistic ball-potting experience. But once you've got the snooker down pat, what else is there to put into a game like this? One feature you'll find here is the addition of these spectral hands. Highly expressive animated gloves vary from region to region and represent your opponents as they take their turns at the table. And then there are the backdrops. There are many varied places to take your snooker table, but the chances are you've never thought of playing on a junk in Hong Kong Harbour or stranded on an isolated desert island. Then there's always the exclusive comfort of the Bond villain's secret hideout. All the settings have plenty going on in the background, so if your opponent is taking his time about a pot, then there's still something to look at. And if all that isn't enough to keep you amused, then there are the entertaining sub-games, such as snooker basketball, endurance thumb wrestling, and even a game of good old-fashioned darts. So for everything snooker and pool that you could possibly want, and much more besides, Jimmy White has got just what you're after. Yeah.
next up tonight, then, the Canadian team.
Salt Lake City 2002 Winter Olympic Games is the officially endorsed game of the Winter Olympics, published by IDOS and the team who brought you Sydney 2000, although this time without the competition from the ESPN Games. There are six events recreated here for you to try your hands at. You can enter into the men's alpine skiing downhill, the ladies' alpine skiing slalom, the men's two-man bobsleigh.
This is the form we knew they were capable of.
Some excellent sliding as they pass through this section. It'll certainly have contributed to their good time.
The women's freestyle skiing aerials.
And that's a poor takeoff. I think the judges will have liked that jump.
The men's ski jumping K120 individual.
And a good transition into his flight. A fantastic jump there. Great distance, great style.
And the men's snowboarding parallel giant slalom.
And the Canadian in the blue lane reaches the halfway mark first.
All of these courses have been lovingly recreated with every twist and turn included to give you as true to life experience as possible.
And don't forget the poor takeoff, which certainly accounted for the majority of her lost points.
There are four play modes to try out, consisting of Olympic, Tournament, Classic and Freeform, as well as an exciting multiplayer option catering for up to four players, including a split-screen slalom race.
Yes, excellent jumping, Stuart. You can see in the replay, he's really found some top form.
And you can play as any one of the 16 countries involved in the events, so there should be something here for everyone to cheer on.
Yes, he held off his opponent well on the bottom section.
Developer Attention to Detail is making every effort to make the experience as authentic as possible. The athletes' animations have been motion captured for each of the events, and the terrain has been precision modelled from first-hand information and satellite imagery to make it accurate to within 2 feet of the real thing. Very impressive considering the length of some of these courses.
They cruise through to the second round. Well, it might be that a more challenging opponent awaits them now.
The physics engine includes inverse kinematics and physical modelling, which amongst other things means that the skier's knees absorb a lot of the bumps of the landscape. And you can adjust the weather conditions to suit your mood, or to make the contest that little bit more challenging.
That was certainly a performance for this Canadian to be proud of, and the result that really couldn't have been better.
Konami's original PS2 snowboarding entry was eclipsed by SSX, but now it's back for another try, with the snappily titled ESPN Winter X Games Snowboarding 2002. Carrying a battery of licenses from ESPN TV, professional snowboarders, boards and other essential gear, you can expect to see a lot of familiar sights here. The 12 snowboarders include gold medalists Peter Line, Todd Richards and Tina Basic. This time, we can expect to see a concentration on the tricks and branching courses, rather than the simple downhill formula of the previous game. The controls are very smooth, which allows you to pull off the tricks without too many difficulties. And the tricks themselves work with a time-based link system, giving the opportunity to link all sorts of moves together in a limited amount of time. There are four events to compete in, consisting of slopestyle, halfpipe, big air, and the newly created border cross events, which feature a six-way downhill competition. These events are held across 20 new courses from around the world, visiting such locations as the Alps, Scandinavia, Japan, Canada, New Zealand, Colorado, and Alaska. The snowboarder mode takes things a step further by allowing you to build up your career from nothing, starting in your hometown and moving around to different locations to earn money, boards and even tricks. The aim is to make your way to the top using signature tricks, acquiring sponsors and moving on to different locales. Will it make a bigger impact than its predecessor? Well, it certainly looks like it has a lot to offer. Rockstar have a history of courting controversy with their games. After the furore caused by the Grand Theft Auto series, they're now going for broke with State of Emergency, an all-out riot simulator. Set in an oppressive city environment, a group called the American Trade Organization has taken control due to the growing unruliness of the populace. In an attempt to minimize organized rebellion, they have restricted access across the city. You play one of five members of this organized resistance. There are four city districts to progress through, and each of them holds over 20 missions, including helping out your fellow resistance fighters, taking apart opposing forces, and generally causing as much mayhem as possible. As you've no doubt noticed, the gameplay primarily consists of out-and-out rioting. Almost everything in the huge environments can be smashed, thrown, or otherwise vandalized, and the Denzians all react differently to your behavior. Some will run for cover, some stand and stare, whilst others join in or even attack you. And the game's engine does an amazing job of keeping it all moving, even allowing up to 100 people to fight on the screen at once. Besides the regular military hardware, there's also a variety of less conventional weapons to be had, such as bricks, benches, and trash cans. You can even pick up dismembered limbs and beat people to a pulp with the wet end. The cartoony graphics are about the only justification for getting away with this kind of behaviour, removing an element of realism and providing a very twisted sense of humour. So that's all right then. Utterly un-PC, State of Emergency could cause offence to a lot of people, but taken as it's intended, it's just a whole load of mindless fun. Let's just hope that everyone sees it that way. THQ is determined to make bass fishing a popular pastime, and Bass Strike sure tries to liven things up with an exciting collage of edited highlights, providing the game's intro sequence. The game itself doesn't do too badly either, with a simple selection of short challenge-themed fishing tests, along with a challenging tournament mode. You'll find yourself cruising about the lakes in your motorboat, searching out those prime fishing spots, trying different lures, and twitching your rod in just the right way to attract those elusive piskeens. At least that's the idea. In fact, these fish seem to have little interest in being caught and even ignore bait hung right in front of their mouths. However, get one hooked and you still have the challenge of bringing it in. You'll need to follow the display to keep track of its movements while spinning the right analog stick to simulate the fishing reel. It makes the whole thing very easy to follow and simple enough for the newcomer to get straight into.
The line's gonna break.
The graphics are a bit primitive compared to what we have come to expect from PS2, especially in the underwater environments. And the collision detection is pretty poor, even allowing the hook and bait to pass through the fish.
Got him!
Add to that some shoddy camera work, and there's plenty of room for improvement here.
Watch your tension.
There is also a bizarre choice of background music for such a gentle game. Fortunately, you can turn this off and relax to the tranquil twittering of birds and the gentle purr of your boat's engine.
I'll take it.
It may look a bit rough, with a strange music track, but the fishing is okay, and that's what counts. It's challenging, with plenty of places to explore and try your luck.
Fight it.
Bass Strike proves to be an acceptable cult game, but probably not something to interest non-fishers.
I'll take it.
Here's something different. How do you fancy becoming the lead actor in a superhero TV series? That's the challenge in Superhero. Fame and fortune can be yours, as long as you prove yourself to be popular. Being a superhero isn't all glamour and epic battles. If the public aren't impressed, then the media will drop you like a chunk of kryptonite. You begin by creating your superhero identity. You'll need a name and then a costume. This can be assembled by selecting the various articles of clothing on offer, giving you an impressive range of over 16 million variations. You also need to name your show. Then you're ready for action. Each episode of your show is 30 minutes long, and in this time you have to uncover the plot, fight the baddies, defeat evil, and save the city. All the time bombarding the viewers with over-the-top acting, cheesy catchphrases, and schlock special effects. Cameras follow your every move as you explore the 17 locations throughout the city. There are 160 different individuals to speak to while searching for the clues to solving your current plot. But if you simply wander around for ages asking the same people the same questions, then your viewing public will be turning off in droves. Whatever you do, you have to make it dynamic and exciting. When your 30 minutes is up, the villain is defeated and everyone is safe to sleep in their beds once more, the credits roll, and there's a final clip showing a sneak preview of next week's show, worth watching for clues as to what to do next time. At this point, your performance is evaluated by the audience reaction. If you've entertained and impressed, then you get to star again next week.
So, what?
The Tekken series is finally facing up to a powerful challenge. Sega's Virtua Fighter games are the pioneers that Namco copied and refined. But since it's a Sega flagship brand, the VF series has never made it onto a Sony system.
I'm gonna whip you in no time!
Until now.
Here I come.
Fight one! Ready, go!
A total of 14 characters have made it into Virtua Fighter 4, each possessing a vast array of terrific acrobatic moves, each based closely on a real-life fighting art. Although a tiny amount of moves are shared between fighters, there seems to be far more individuality in the characters' techniques compared to Tekken 4, which makes for far more varied fights. Punches, kicks, throws, and counterattacks are unleashed with a ferocity and silkiness quite unlike any other fighting game. Virtua Fighter veterans will find two new characters added to the mix following the arcade and Dreamcast-only VF3. Lei Fi is a superb creation. Tremendously disciplined martial arts chained together to produce absolutely mesmerizing displays. He's the closest video games have yet to get to the celluloid performances of Jet Li.
Come on!
The other newcomer is the buff Vanessa. Possessed of outlandish physical power and a bewildering range of grappling attacks that are quite brutal to behold. The backgrounds in the game also push the envelope. Destructible parts of the scenery are also in Tekken 4, but Virtua Fighter 4 is clearly a lot more detailed and presents some impressive new effects never seen before, such as fighting through a snowdrift on the excellent castle stage. Put simply, this is the best fighting game yet seen on the PlayStation 2. In fact, it's even better than the arcade version of Tekken 4, meaning that Namco has finally got some serious competition. Import fans should definitely snap this up double quick, but European PS2 owners are promised a full-screen, full-speed version of the game in time for its official release in April. We'll have far more in-depth Virtua Fighter 4 coverage next month.
Virtua Fighter 4.
Motocross games have always been a very mixed bag, but EA Sports Big aims to change all that with the release of Freakstyle, bringing the tricking arcade style of their other games to the mud tracks of the motocross world.
It's go time!
As you might expect, there are plenty of game modes to get your teeth into, along with a wide variety of environments and a lively soundtrack.
Double can-can, with a heart attack. We are underway.
The riders are all recognizable licensed big names, each with their own style, double bike, and a wardrobe full of outfits.
Barhawk, freak out meters almost full.
And they're all itching to get out there and roar through the mud at insane speeds, attempting huge jumps and as many tricks as they can manage.
Superman seat grab.
As with all EA Sports big titles, the tricks make up a large part of the game, with more than 80 different stunts to master.
Barhawk. Donkey kick.
And if that isn't enough, then you can try combining them for even more points.
No-hander.
There are 9 different venues to explore, each of them filled with hidden paths and shortcuts, littered with obstacles and sporting exciting new scenery.
The freaks are about to be unleashed on Los Infernos.
The game modes include circuit, race, freestyle, and free ride options, along with split-screen head-to-head two-player modes.
Superman, donkey kick, whip.
Freakstyle's blend of motocross and over-the-top tricking arcade action is definitely showing some great potential.
I smell a freakout coming.
Dynasty Warriors 3 draws on China's ancient feudal history for its setting, so if you don't like the idea of massive and bloody sword battles on horseback, look away now. For both cooperative and single-player story modes, you're thrust into a tale based loosely on the ancient Chinese novel Romance of the Three Kingdoms. It's the very same storyline that developer Kaori chose for its other feudal fights in Kessen 2. Within this seemingly endless conflict between three factions, you get to choose from a huge selection of characters allied to any one of the warring sides. And many of Kessen 2's feudal warlords are also present in the frenzy. Versus mode provides a standard one-on-one punch-up. However, it's the cooperative mode where things really start to get brutal. You and a mate can slay the advancing hordes from the opposite sides of the battlefield or just wade in, side by side, for a multi-weapon onslaught. Combos are now much more elaborate.
Don't fall behind!
Far exceeding those in Dynasty Warriors 2, with massive multiple hit moves that can take out a crowd of 20 enemies in one lethal stroke. And you can even stomp through the battlefields on horseback. Also, you're now given the opportunity to select your preferred weapons, items and bodyguard formations. These faithful sidekicks provide essential backup, and like your chosen character, they gain experience with every successful skirmish. Unfortunately, there's a price to pay for the amount of characters on screen, and that comes in the form of a fogging effect that limits the view to just a few meters in front of you. Despite these grievances, Kaori's latest adventure builds on what made DW2 such an invigorating fighting experience, and could well be a worthy alternative to the fourth installment of Tekken and Virtua Fighter.
Brother, let's go!
The first game of the Worms series to make it to PS2, Worms Blast, follows the continuing adventures of those plucky little worms. But this time, they've changed their style, leaning more towards a puzzle bobble kind of approach. The principle is simple. Fire the coloured blobs at similarly coloured blobs to eliminate. Clear all the blobs and move on to the next level. But where things get interesting is in the multiplayer games. Here you can use your considerable arsenal of intriguingly named weaponry to put your opponent out of the game, whilst making progress yourself. The hardware at your disposal consists of torpedoes, fish food, reverse controls, frozen time, speed up, double damage and lasers. All of these can be wielded by any of the nine worms, each of which has their own boat, with its own characteristics. So there are plenty of strategies to be considered at every stage of the game. There are numerous power-ups to collect, any of which could give you an advantage when it comes to debilitating the other worm or improving your own position. For instance, falling stars can be collected to lower the water level, giving you a bit more room to maneuver. Ubisoft has gone to some effort to provide a variety of game modes to keep you entertained. You can test your mettle with the deathmatch, try a tide trial, or take the survival challenge to name but a few. There are 8 multiplayer modes in total, along with an increasingly complicated single-player mode. While it may not look quite as slick as many of the current PS2 games, there is a definite mental challenge to be found here. But will engrossing gameplay be enough to carry it? Check out next month's review to find out. Parappa the Rapper has been quiet since he burst onto the PS1 scene all those years ago, but now he's back with a PS2 sequel. The original game saw Parappa, the lovable, flat, dog-like thing, trying to win the heart of Sunny Funny. But now things have become a little more complicated. Parappa Town has been invaded by the dastardly Noodle Gang, who are intent on transforming all town's foodstuffs into noodles. Since Parappa has a summer job in a burger joint and is thoroughly sick of noodles, his only option is to rat the Noodle Gang out of town.
Very nice. You got the heat.
As before, the concept is to watch and copy what you see. The various senses will lead with a quick rap, and then it's Parappa's turn. Press the indicated buttons in time with the display, and you'll be cheered on to victory and increasingly complicated sequences. If you should foul it up, then you'll be booed off the stage and kicked out of town like the ham-fisted, rhythmless reject you are.
Master that guarantees the season. The final block coming, no denying.
To help him along, Parappa has the usual suspects, his best friend PJ Berry, significant other Sunny Funny, and Lammy's rock band Milk Cans.
You wanna just forget it and just take a picture? You wanna just forget it and just take a picture? I carry a camera for all my adventures. You carry a camera for all your adventures.
That was good! Can you please take a picture?
Sure!
There's also a whole new array of teachers ready to bring Parappa up to speed on all the latest raps and styles that he'll need to defeat the Noodle Gang.
That a boy, Parappa!
Hey, I'm off to a good start!
Sophia!
Maximo! Achille, you told me Maximo...
Silence!
That's enough, Achille!
You little fool! I control your kingdom now, as I control the power of the underworld!
Sophia!
Maximo is a progression of the old Ghosts and Goblins games. But even if you never played those classic coin-ops, this will still be a joy to experience, with just the right level of challenge to be fun. There's plenty of leaping around to be done, in between desecrating gravestones for lost souls and looting treasure chests. Each of Maximo's six worlds has a central level, around which are strange obelisks. Smashing these gives access to the sub-levels, and each one must be completed before access to the hub is granted. Here you'll meet numerous bosses, tough enough to be fun, but not so hard as to keep you stuck in an annoying loop of failures. There are plenty of different enemies to take on too, most of which rise up out of the ground as you approach. Although you eventually realise they appear from the same places each time, the game's simply too large for you to learn them all and become bored. Despite the cartoonish style, we defy anyone not to be taken with Maximo's smooth and free-flowing world. The difficulty level is particularly well judged throughout, and the only downside to this old-school adventure is that it eventually comes to an end. Still, with 18 hours of gaming on offer, it's an awesome challenge with great replay value. Sadly, the most interesting feature of Winter X Games Snowboarding 2002 is the superb video sequence in the introduction. It's a great way to start, but Konami has failed to meet the challenge of SSX Tricky and Sean Palmer's Pro Snowboarder when it comes to gameplay. Despite the ESPN license and a battery of official endorsements, the overall experience is rather flat to say the least. Border X mode provides a limited number of events to compete in, but there are various routes to be discovered in the five-man race of Border Cross mode. So long as you take the red and blue gates alternately throughout the sparse white plains, everything's fine. Miss one out, and your chances of victory will dissolve for good. And even the alternate routes are every bit as dull and featureless as the main racing channels.
Look at him, trying to show off even in a situation like this, and he kills it!
In slopestyle mode, the layouts of ramps and rails provide a brief moment of grind satisfaction, and once you've seen one halfpipe, you've seen them all. Snowboarder mode takes things a step further by allowing you to build up your career from scratch, starting in your hometown and moving around to different locations to earn money, boards, and more tricks. Sadly, the tricks are pretty lifeless too. The jumps are relatively short-lived, so there's not much opportunity to exploit the limited and rather dull selection of grabs. Even if this was the only snowboarding game available, we wouldn't recommend it. One of the things that really stood out during Star Wars Episode 1 was the pod racing sequence. It was destined to become a racing game, and here it is.
It takes split-second reflexes, a whim of iron, supernatural control and concentration, and the near-suicidal drive and ambition to pilot what can only be called the fastest and deadliest racecraft in existence.
There's a welcome lack of fogging, and the races are all incredibly smooth and fast.
Oh, look at that abuse!
The tracks are well designed, with plenty of surprises, alternate routes, and exciting scenery, allowing you to show off some fancy flying. and there are five worlds to race on, each with significantly different terrain to cope with, although the jungle setting leaves a bit to be desired.
He's really throwing his weight around on the track.
The opposition are very aggressive.
Oh, and Albarbino goes down.
Trying their hardest to push you out of the race and into the scenery.
For all your collision and repair needs, check out Watto's Repair Bay.
This is entertaining to begin with, but can soon become annoying when you're crowded for every second of every race.
Look at that beatdown.
Fortunately, you score extra points for totaling the opposition, so it's worth pushing back for more than just some breathing room.
Flaming wreckage is everywhere.
You also get a choice of control methods. For the straightforward approach and the chance to concentrate on the track, there's the normal control method seen in so many other racing games. But more adventurous players can use the two analog sticks, each controlling one of the engines. This takes plenty of coordination, but can be really satisfying when you pull it off. Disappointingly, the whole season of 13 races can be completed in less than 4 hours.
That's gonna be one expensive repair bill.
And the difficulty level seems to peak in the middle of that period. The Boontar Eve Classic finale is surprisingly easy with all your shiny new upgrades. This short lifespan is stretched somewhat by all the features that you'll unlock along the way, and the desire to upgrade your new pods to the max.
He just will not be pushed around.
The multiplayer mode is also something of a disappointment, but overall, Race of Revenge proves to be a decent bit of high-speed action.
Mandrell taking a beating out there. Experience the pulse-pounding excitement, fierce competition, tragic defeats, and heroic victories. So tune in for the fastest sport in the galaxy. Pod Racing, back with a vengeance.
Star Wars Jedi Starfighter 2 brings Episode 2 to your PS2 even before the movie is released. Unfortunately, the three stars of the game bear no resemblance to anyone who has been or ever will be in the movies. Fortunately, the locations and vehicles are taken from the movies.
This ship is not for sale. It is a prototype that may become a powerful aid to the Jedi.
Is sending in reinforcements.
Nim, this is the Liberator. We can't get any closer. Those station defense cannons will punch right through us.
The game bears a strong resemblance to the previous Starfighter game. This time round, it still comes with a selection of deep space and planet-side missions, but there's not much in the way of exciting new features. It certainly looks better, and you get a total of 40 new craft, including the massive capital ships, many of which appear in the movie. In addition, there are over 20 big missions and an enjoyable cooperative mode.
I'm under fire!
You gave her the comm codes too? Ready, when I'm done with you, you're gonna be stuffed and mounted.
You and Orsai are carrying enough explosives to blow us all to Coruscant. We're gonna make sure at least one of you gets into the sensor station to take it out.
We're ready, Nim.
There are four force powers to play with, which can be used every 30 seconds or so when the energy bar recovers. These allow you to pull off tricks, like reflecting enemy shots back at them, adding a whole new tactical element to the space fighting.
We're coming up on Nim's last known coordinates. Muckworms! Doesn't look good.
Then give us cover while Jenkins slices into the Trade Federation planetary network.
Enemy sighted!
The entire combat system!
Now is not the time.
Your wingmates are controlled from a separate navigation menu, but as usual, they're hopelessly ineffective. They are very enthusiastic, though, and make a good show of filling the sky with laser fire.
Launch the backup surveillance device!
Friendly fire! Friendly fire!
can become a bit dull fighting wave after wave of enemies, and the graphics lag a bit in the planet missions, but Jedi Starfighter 2 is still an essential buy for Star Wars fans.
In fragments.
Blood Omen 2 sees the return of the ancient and bloodthirsty vampire Kane, ensuring that this is not a game for the faint of heart.
You were struck down and destroyed.
Death.
Awakening 200 years after his last appearance, he's fighting to rebuild his powers.
I am Uma, and I am here to help you.
From the shards of tattered dreams, I rose. I am Kane.
You have been asleep for 200 years. This is what has become of Nazgûl. Blood is your life. Vampires possess dark gifts. You have the ability to assume a mist form. Know that you are stronger and faster than mortal men. Able to jump higher and farther than any human that ever lived. It's time for you to learn how to kill.
I needed little training in how to kill.
With simple controls, well-designed levels, and the chance to be subtle and cunning if you so desire, Blood Omen 2 looks set to bring the fun back into action adventures. You can find out more about the return of everyone's favorite vampire in this month's magazine preview. The Vampire Lord is back, and he's back in style.
Tell them Kane is coming.
Rhythm Entertainment is rapidly becoming a big market, with big names like Parappa the Rapper and Space Channel 5 being joined by newcomers like Rez and Now Frequency. Frequency comes with what is probably the best selection of music ever to hit PS2, including 25 tracks from quality artists in a wide range of styles, and you get the chance to remix and generally muck about with the whole lot. Each stage features a single tune, and a flight down this mesmerizing tunnel. A different element of the current track, such as the drum section, vocals or bass line, is represented by one of the 8 tunnel walls. And as you hurtle down the tunnel, you're faced with symbols left, right and center, which you need to match in sequence on the joypad in order to initialize that element of the music. The meter on the right keeps track of your progress through the stage, and the aim is to complete each of the elements before the end of the section. On top of that, if you make mistakes, your power bar becomes depleted, and if you pick up the bonuses, then you can multiply your score or automatically play the track to the end of that section. But it's not all about collecting points. Most of the entertainment comes from mixing in different parts of the music, experiencing the effects that you can generate, and watching the psychedelic kaleidoscope that fills the screen. The only drawback is the same old problem that plagues a lot of rhythm games. It's a lot more interesting for those watching than the person who has to keep their eyes on the symbols all the time. Fortunately, since the major feature is the music, this doesn't pose too much of a disadvantage. Described as a roaming 3D beat-em-up, Eve of Extinction is the latest fight fest from the people who brought us WWF SmackDown. You play Josh, who has just discovered that his employers are developing a weapon of mass destruction, the Legacy, by fusing the human soul with a crystal. Taking the sensible course of action when faced with a plot like that, he tries to make a run for it with his girlfriend, but that doesn't work, and he's soon captured and introduced firsthand to the experiments.
Show him what you've got!
Fortunately, being a hero and all, he manages to escape, and now he's setting out to save his girl, the world, and anything else that takes his fancy along the way. What this bizarre and implausible story actually means is that you have to demolish absolutely everything that wanders into your path. Except your girlfriend, of course. Probably shouldn't attack her. This is an early version of the game, so there's still time for improvements to be made and more detail to be added. Fingers crossed.
Status.
Captain, we have reports of secondary EPS conduits on decks 8 and 9 rupturing.
Photon torpedoes, full spread.
Trekkies rejoice. Star Trek Voyager Elite Force is the fabulous first-person shooter that actually does justice to the Star Trek setting. Already immensely popular on PC, it's now coming to PlayStation 2. There's a totally new story, created by one of the show's writers. Here we find Voyager trapped without power, in an uncharted space junkyard. As a member of the away team, Ensign Monroe and his teammates must search the surrounding wrecks for a means of escape. But not all of these space hulks are deserted, and a whole menagerie of alien scavengers want a piece of you.
Monroe to Tuvok. I've been cut off from the rest of the hazard team. I don't know where they are.
There are lots of familiar species to be found here, along with a few new ones, and all of them are going to require a unique approach. Some you can fight, others will require a more stealthy approach.
Sir, I was hit. The Borg took the team through there.
Ouch, Chang.
Whatever happens, it's up to you to make the most of your team and ensure that they all return safely.
Thanks, Monroe. I'll get Odell back to the ship.
Even when the mission takes an unexpected turn for the worse.
EPS conduits are gonna blow! Hit that panel and bring up a containment field!
You'll get to interact with all the significant members of the Voyager crew. Some will join you on missions and others debrief you, but not everyone has time for the petty concerns of a lowly hazard team member.
Ensign Monroe, you're wearing a hazard suit. Get down to engineering and help Bellana seal that leak.
Here, Monroe, take this.
You even get to hear the real voices of Tuvok and the Doctor.
If you need medical attention, just come back here.
Elite Force carries all the atmosphere of the Star Trek universe, whilst plunging you into the middle of the action. And it even manages to be an excellent first-person shooter in its own right. Certainly worth monitoring closely. Change of pace from all the guns and racing. Iko is just the tonic you've been looking for. Set among the ancient stones of a strange old castle, you're presented with a constant challenge in the form of intricate puzzles as you try to rescue the princess and keep the shadowy forces of the Dark Queen at bay. This is Iko, a young boy who's been exiled from his village because of the horns growing out of his head. The superstitious villagers locked him away in the deserted stronghold, where he begins to have visions of a princess held within the walls. He soon finds her prison, and his adventure really begins. The game consists almost entirely of exploring the marvellously detailed and gorgeously ethereal castle, as you find or create an easy route in order to lead the fragile princess, Yorda, to freedom. The puzzles flow together well, and don't come across as simply a series of hurdles, but as a beautifully flowing storyline. The only interruptions in the serene wanderings of our diminutive hero are the occasional assaults by the shadow monsters, sent by the sinister Dark Queen to capture Yorda. These fights seem eerily appropriate in the general ambience of the game, with the only sounds being Iko's desperate attempts to fight the things off. Yorda does a good job of being completely vague, getting distracted by the animals and needing to be continually led around. The first time through the game, you get no clues about what she's saying to you, but things will become a little clearer the second time around. With a calm, haunting atmosphere, a thought-provoking series of puzzles, and an evocative storyline, the whole game is relaxing and refreshing, while still providing an ample challenge. Bursts onto the ninja scene, coming up against such opposition as Onimusha and Seven Blades. You get to play Hero the Ninja, faced with a wide selection of puzzles that, while they may not be the most challenging obstacles in the world, won't detract from the action at all. The main aspect of the game is the fighting, of which there's plenty.
Crap!
There are loads of flashy moves to pull off, and many of them actually prove to be useful as well. And the action just keeps on coming. The restricted view doesn't prove to be as irritating as you might first expect. Although it would be nice to see a bit more in the game's few open areas. The graphics can be a bit glitchy on occasion, but are generally good, including some decent water and motion blur effects, along with several amusing character animations. character progression keeps things interesting as the game continues to grow, and being resurrected where you fell also keeps the action moving along nicely. Godai Elemental Force works well as a game, albeit one with a slight smell of a budget title.
Zola Dane, royal seer and advisor to Lady Mishala. It is an honor to meet you.
Thank you.
Draken, the ancient Gates, has followed the wise marketing strategy of having an attractive female lead, but it has much more to offer than merely this, with an extensive storyline and some beautiful scenery. The action follows our heroine, Rin, and her talking dragon, marauding around the landscape, fighting monsters, talking to villagers, and looting everything in sight, before heading into town to purchase the latest in adventure sheep. The main plot is huge, with side quests being issued by almost everyone you meet. If anything, there's probably more to do here than is actually necessary.
And of them all, none was greater than the dragon mother, Malashe. It's said that if she can be awakened, so too will the last dragons of the Order.
But those are just legends.
The legends are true.
The controls are well designed and easy to master, and the combat system includes an interesting locking function, which means you can stay focused on a particular opponent while trying to avoid being hit. There are some great battles to be had flying on the back of your dragon, in which you get to breathe huge swathes of flame across your enemies.
Did you find the site, Arok?
I did, but the trees were too dense. I couldn't get close. I'm afraid I'll need you to journey into the swamps for me, Rin.
That's a fine greeting.
The graphics are beautiful, including some gorgeous rolling landscapes, highly detailed textures and objects, and some fantastic character models. As you visit locations, they automatically appear on your map, making navigation a cinch. And you can save the game any way you like, although it will eat up a large chunk of your memory card in the process.
Will you do as I ask?
Payment, wizard. What can you offer us?
Two souls, priest.
While it may look like many other games that have gone before it, Draken proves to be bigger, better, and much more fun than the majority of its competitors. Shortage of snow-themed games around at the moment, and here's another one. Rather than going head-to-head with the awesome SSX Tricky, Dark Summit offers a winter sports game with a plot. It seems that harmful pollutants are being dumped on a popular ski resort, sections of which have been sealed off by security chief O'Leary. Your character, Naya, has been sent in to investigate, and she soon unearths a complex X-Files-style conspiracy involving aliens and military cover-ups. It's all very strange, but it does provide an incentive to keep on with the challenges.
Well, I haven't seen you here before.
Hey, sorry about that.
If I find out that some punk snowboarder isn't following the rules, then I will crack down.
You tell him, Chief.
Out on the slopes, you'll find the courses are absolutely huge and littered with all sorts of obstacles and interesting playthings to trick off. There are also lots of varied challenges to keep you occupied.
This is my day.
Even if some of them are a bit strange and disturbing. The tricks are easy to perform and usually look good, and there are a few special tricks that are a bit more taxing. You can learn more of these as you progress through the game, completing the challenges. The visuals are very nice, including some lovely animations and scenery interaction, and the game physics are spot on. You even get a multiplayer mode. The biggest problem is the sheer size of the courses.
Now this is getting interesting.
This is only the beginning.
Whilst it's great for just fooling about on, it's a real pitch to find all the challenge points and to discover where you're going in order to complete them. Dark Summit does a good job of putting a plot into a snowboarding game. Its visuals are beautiful, and the actual snowboarding is great fun. But it still doesn't quite manage to be as attractive as SSX Tricky, although it certainly makes a nice change. Frank Herbert's Dune is one of the great classics of the sci-fi genre. So why is it that no one can produce a decent film or game about it?
Location. We are on Arrakis, otherwise known as Dune, the planet of sand. This is the only known source in the entire universe of the essential spice.
The effort is based on the recent TV miniseries rather than the book or the 1984 David Lynch movie, but it still fails to include the image of any of the actors. You play Paul Atreides, battling to defeat the evil schemes of the Baron Harkonnen, while making alliances with the desert Fremen, dodging the giant sandworms and struggling to avenge the destruction of your family.
Raban, you must recapture Dune. Its surrender has been very costly to us. Our investment must pay dividends.
The Fremen are more than just a scattered bunch of natives. Our soldiers report that they are fearsome fighters.
Show yourself!
The idea is to use a mixture of stealth, cunning, and all-out violence to outmaneuver your opponents. But the whole thing falls far short of that ideal. For a start, the biggest problem isn't the Harkonnens or the worms, but the camera. You can choose to control it yourself using the right analog stick, or let the AI look after it for you. But neither method works at all well, often leaving you fighting creatures off the screen or desperately trying to evade the worms as you run into the camera shot. The graphics don't help. The worms look impressive, but the jerky animations and atrocious lip syncs are a sight that everyone on Dune is eating the wrong kind of spice.
Transport until we get to the ambush point. Has Baron explained how the SOS jammer works?
It jams the Harvester's communication network and sends a false SOS to the carry-all.
The whole thing falls short of what it could have been. Dune is a great license, but even hardcore fans will find this offering leaves a bad taste in their mouths. There are plenty of better action games available on the PS2. Rage has taken up the challenge to fill a gaping hole in the sports game market. So now you no longer need to fret and worry over the absence of aggressive inline skating games in your life. Now you have rolling. Welcome to Tony Hawk on Rollerblades. Gonna call all the shots for the notes and the knobs because I wanna. There are over 300 motion-captured tricks with a special photo shoot mode where you can show them off to photographers for fame and sponsorship. And there are currently 18 recognisable pros to choose between, as well as the chance to make your own skate park star. There are 14 levels to grind through, 10 artificial urban areas and 4 real-life skate parks, including Liverpool's own Rampwork Skate Park. Rolling is still in the early stages of development, and we can expect to see richer backgrounds, fancy effects, and plenty more by the time it glides onto the shelves towards the end of the year. Sometimes, just sometimes, there comes along a game that has it all. And Medal of Honor Frontline is indeed one of those games. But this is more than just a game. This pushes PS2 to the limits, with beautiful visuals, awesome sounds, and perfectly intuitive controls. From the very start, you're thrown into the heart of the action, amongst the D-Day landings. The atmosphere is amazing, with sounds, visuals, and sheer adrenaline-pumping terror reaching fever pitch as you join in with hundreds of others, storming the beaches amongst a hail of gunfire and artillery bombardment. There's no sense of being an indestructible hero here. The opportunities for an unsung death are evident all around you. Truly terrifying and truly exhilarating. The AI only adds to the sense of drama, with enemy soldiers diving for cover, searching out suspicious sounds and laying down suppressive fire. They'll use their dead allies as shields and rush to man unoccupied sentry guns. On the other hand, you can also catch them off guard, or even suffering at the hands of some courageous local. But the AI also works for you. This is no solo run into the heart of enemy territory. Here you have a team of friends with you, shouting instructions, providing covering fire, and coming to your aid when things get really messy. You really feel like part of a team. The scenery, sounds, and astounding attention to detail create an awesome atmosphere, filling you with a sense of despair and pointlessness, along with the exhilaration of making a difference. After that, some extremely satisfying weapons and the panic-inducing inability to save anywhere, and you have an experience second to none. There may be no multiplayer options, but if that's what it takes to create a single-player game as impressive as Medal of Honor Frontline, then we're prepared to let that one slide. Just let yourself get caught up in the emotionally charged, vibrantly chaotic experience of World War II, and thank God that you didn't actually have to be there for real.
I have full confidence in your courage, devotion to duty, and skill in battle. We will accept nothing less than full victory. Good luck. And lest us all beseech the blessings of Almighty God upon this great and noble undertaking.
Crazy cool music and crazy cool driving when you push the start button. So come on, let's go. Crazy Taxi. Hey, 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 it's time to make some crazy money. Are you ready? Here we go.
Taxi.
One of the most popular games produced by Sega for their Dreamcast console was Crazy Taxi. And now, thanks to Sega's decision to support PS2, this popular title is now available for the attractive sum of 20 quid. The objectives are very straightforward. Get your taxi, find a passenger, and then bomb across the city to your drop point. You have a choice of four cabbies to put through their paces, each with their requisite strengths and weaknesses. Then, once you're up and running, you can try to master some of the nifty moves to help take these seconds off your journey time.
Beady Joe!
Yeah, we're gonna have some fun!
Hey, it's time to make some crazy money, are you ready? Here we go!
Once you get started, it becomes very addictive, spicing up the action with a whole series of special moves you can pull off to get that little bit quicker. If that's not enough, then there are also a number of sub-games and challenges to break up the flow, along with a selection of crazy secret vehicles and cheat modes to keep you playing again and again. Crazy Drift assists power sliding around corners. Crazy Dash will help you get that extra burst of speed. And Crazy Jumps get you soaring over the less reckless motorists. Learn to combine these in interesting ways, and you'll soon be streets ahead of the competition.
Stop driving, huh?
Okay, we're gonna fly.
Undeniably good fun. Crazy Taxi deserves a place in everyone's gaming collection. Dave Mirra Freestyle BMX comes aggressive inline. This rollerblading extravaganza uses the next generation graphics engine found in Dave Mirra 2 and combines it with a new physics and gameplay system to bring you something just a bit different. Nine of the top pro skaters are featured, including Shane Yost and Chris Edwards, who contributed to the motion capturing as well. Character models move well and are nicely detailed and feature dynamic hair and clothing. And the graphics are enhanced with a dynamic lighting engine, particle effects and the new vertex shader. There are nine huge levels packed full of rails, ramps, pipes and surprises. And there are between 30 and 60 objectives and a dozen or so cinematic events per level. So there's always plenty to see and do. But if you still want more, then you can make use of the level editor included and make some parts of your own. The all-new arcade-style trick system provides you with a vast array of over-the-top tricks. Some new moves particularly worthy of mention are the Cess Slide, which lets you link to four different manuals and create huge combos, and the Veil, which can help avoid disaster by allowing you to land on your feet instead of your face after a botched trick attempt. The context-sensitive action button lets you perform vaults, horizontal and vertical spins, skitches and bails, as well as being your means of communicating with the various bystanders in order to pick up new challenges. Add to that a dynamic attribute system that lets your character evolve depending upon how you play the game, and aggressive inline is shaping up to be one great game.
Pick it up, pick it up, pick it up! Back on the scene, crispy and clean! Come on!
going to compare aggressive inline to Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 3, but can it possibly beat the superb style of Activision's Celebrity Skateboarder? There's more emphasis here on the swinging and jumping side of things, and the key innovation comes with the all-powerful action button, a press of which opens up a whole new world of extreme possibilities. It's your wall ride button, your vaulting over walls button, skating beneath a bar, the action button hooks you onto it, flipping you about before throwing you up to a higher place for more tricks and stunts. There's also the highly annoying juice gauge, encouraging you to continually perform tricks. Should your gauge empty itself after about 30 seconds or so of trick and activity, it's game over. Undeniably, the skate worlds themselves are huge, but they all look rather familiar to say the least. There's even a house in the film set that's identical to the one in Tony Hawk 3, even coming with a short surrounding wall and metal railings. It's not an original game, that's for sure. You'll also need to work bloody hard to see the full array of creatively challenged levels. While the challenges within each level are painfully difficult, actually controlling the skaters and performing tricks is dead easy. There's even a very forgiving balance meter that makes it harder to fall off the rails than stay on. Overall, aggressive inline has a good shot at doing a Tony Hawk on blades, and the trickery is simpler than the weeks of learning required to get the best out of Tony Hawk 3. Unfortunately, 10 characters, 7 levels, a park editor, and few multiplayer games is not the way to impress, and the poor choice of B-list rock tunes make this a poor man's Tony Hawk 3. With the exception of Tony himself, who gets his copy for free, everyone's going to be shelling out for Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 4. Last time you were activating events and taking on challenges, this time it all starts on the amateur scene with a new single-player angle, designed around the ambition of moving through the ranks and becoming a pro. Designed to more realistically portray the struggles of an upcoming boarder, Tony 4's non-linear career mode is based around learning tricks, challenging established pros, entering competitions and taking on challenges at will. Winning certain challenges activates new trick areas as before, evolving the levels as you improve. Of course, there will be minor changes, tweaked moves and newer levels, but we're 99% sure that Tony 4 will be just as great as the last outing, if not better. If you're a fan of EA's trick-based snowboarder SSX, you'll find a lot of freestyle eerily familiar. But the similarity is not a bad thing. SSX did a great job simulating snow and ice, and freestyle is most definitely stuck firmly in the mud. What makes EA's latest mud skipper so entertaining is that you can never let up and just cruise. Just as in SSX, tricks equal boost, and boost equals speed. You really have to make the most of every jump to maintain enough boost to keep up. You also need to fill the red left-hand side to access the Uberstar Super Sick trick, which leads to Matrix-style camera work, brilliant sound effects, back tire flames, and ultra-high speeds. Keep tricking and it'll keep boosting. The result, when you get it right, is highly rewarding. and the tricks are hilarious too. Without a doubt, our favourite is the screw loose, where the rider completely lets go of the bike and flies back to the saddle, flapping his arms like a bird. Not only do the riders have tricks of their own, but the bikes have unique moves. With all this going on, there's significant replay value simply because there are so many moves to see. Tracks contain all the ramps and breakable features you'd expect to find, but smoothie shortcuts are just a little too well hidden. Occasionally, routes are signposted with barrels or boxes just begging to be crashed into, but the game's furious speed actually works against it here, as you haven't got very long to look around. Circuit mode is the main thrust of the game, and the place all the good stuff lurks to be unlocked. This career-type mode also takes in freestyle stunt competition in special arenas, but these lack the sense of urgency and danger of the racetracks. Two-player doesn't add much either, even though you can choose to either race for the line or for points, but there are no other riders on the track. Freakstyle's by far the best biking game around, beating MotoGP and MX 2002 on final playability. It's fast, it's smooth, and everything seems in place. A brilliant arcade experience. One of the best games of last year is getting a sequel, and considering its brilliance, expectations for Devil May Cry 2 are massively high. Dante's attacks are even more stylish than before, and while he still depends on a combination of guns and swords, all will be vastly upgraded along with some powerful new additions and extra visual appeal. Capcom's decision to remove Dante from the confined indoor spaces of the first game means a much broader selection of environments will be included. In fact, much of the game is set outdoors and includes Gotham-like cityscapes and old European towns. This all fits in nicely with the new story and overhaul mission structure, which Capcom still remains vague about. But we've also been given a brief glimpse of Dante's new soulmate, a mysterious red-headed heroine who's playable from the beginning of the story. Capcom has finally realised the importance of 60Hz conversions, and hopefully there'll be no heavy black borders to spoil our viewing. But can it wow us second time around? Chances are high, but only time will tell. Enter the Wild West with Red Dead Revolver and take on the role of Capcom's latest hero, a mysterious, gritty stranger going by the name of Red. The story begins in the savage frontier of the American West, where a hard-working homestead family is attacked by bandits and left for dead. The young boy, Red, is the only survivor, and he's soon adopted by a local Indian, who teaches him the ways of the land. Many years later, a mysterious gunfighter appears in the town. Fighting with honor and seeking vengeance, Red is determined to make the lawless fear for their lives. The fast-action gunslinger-style battles include a detailed targeting system and give you the chance to ride and fight from horseback, use flawless gunfighter skills, stealth, hand-to-hand combat, and plenty of other sides. And there's lots of old-time Western artillery to play with, including pistols, shotguns, whips, and dynamite, with special combat moves and a variety of power-ups to spice up the action. There's even a multiplayer battle mode for up to 4 players to complete that Red Dead Revolver Western experience. Disney's latest 3D platformer is your typical love story. Cat meets robot, cat helps robot save world, robot transforms into boat, pair float off to live happily ever after.
Listen up, you lard balls! That was the most pathetic display I have ever seen on that obstacle course!
What do you mean?
We finished the circuit, ma'am.
Oh yeah, but it is weak. Weak, weak!
Ratchet & Clank boasts a bizarre arsenal of weaponry, with over 35 guns and gadgets to play with. Even Clank himself, your little robot chum, may be upgraded with thrusters, jetpacks and a mini helicopter to add plenty of new angles to the standard platforming action.
How does a helipack upgrade sound?
Upgrade?
Match. Since he's a 766, I could have the little guy up and flying in no time. Of course, I'll just need my fee.
Ratchet isn't quite so versatile, but at least he has two hands to wield guns with. You'll have to buy these weapons as you progress through the levels, and after a substantial amount of bolt grabbing, you'll soon be able to afford the big ones. There's a bomb glove, a bolt blaster, and the top-of-the-range devastator for homing in on the more evasive targets. You play as Ratchet most of the time, occasionally switching to his RoboPal Clank for the odd mini mission. But what's really impressive is the overall smoothness. You'll never see graphical judder, and the world stretched for many game miles off into the distance. The vast alien city is particularly stunning. Skyscrapers line the horizon, birds and vehicles whiz about constantly, and never does the game need to mask its edges with the fading grey fog that is the destroyer of so many other game atmospheres. It's colourful, smooth and pretty. Ratchet & Clank should contain as many new gameplay ideas as it does pretty little touches. It certainly seems like it will at the moment.
Quark Enterprises is not responsible for sprains, broken bones, snapped tendons, bruised egos or accidental death incurred while taking the challenge.
You won't be surprised to hear that much of this new platform game involves leaping around collecting coins in a similar vein to the superb Jak and Daxter and forthcoming Ratchet & Clank.
Bentley calling Sly Cooper! Do you read me? Come in! Come in!
Can you yell a little louder so the guards can hear you too?
So what differentiates this from the competition? For starters, there's the use of cell shading, the technique of colouring 3D objects to make them appear as 2D, comic book style. Certainly impressive, it has to be said, and the slightly more cerebral approach to the gameplay is welcome too.
I've marked the areas you need to hit with holographic markers. Follow them to your objectives.
At various points, players need to exercise a little stealth as the game promotes crafty risk-taking, promising a greater level of intrigue to the overall play. It's also a strong story-based affair too. On Sly's 8th birthday, he receives the coveted Thievius Raccoonus, a family heirloom containing all the secrets of super successful robbery. His family are the world's greatest jewel thieves, but a band of robbers break into the family home the very night of Sly's birthday and steal the book. Sly, his gadget-making friend Bentley and Murray head out to reclaim the scattered portions of text. Each gaming area has three tiers of objectives, some of which are quite frankly absurd, to say the least, and not every useful item you chance upon is immediately obvious, prompting us to invest more time in exploration. There's no way Sly Raccoon will fail to impress, but beyond the shiny exterior, will there be enough to truly differentiate it from the stunning rivalry? The whole thing's around 40% complete so far, and while we certainly hope the latter levels are a little more alluring, this game is shaping up to be very promising indeed. Thank you. Prisoner of War combines all the military drama of the Great Escape.
Rudder's gone. Pitch controls.
With almost comical stereotypes more commonly found in the likes of a lower low.
Save it for the crowds, JD. She's going down.
Portly German generals and tally-ho stiff upper lip Britishness are the order of the day as you immerse yourself in the daily grind of 1940s prison camp culture.
Hände hoch! Hände hoch! Grab your weapon, American!
Initially, the world in Prisoner of War is not an easy one to navigate, and the only way to work out the route to freedom is to prize every snippet of information from your fellow Allied captives.
You ready to get the Krauts off of my back?
Good to go, boss. Leave the guards to me. You go check out the Krauts barracks. Come and find me when you've got that key.
Chatting to nearly every prisoner in the camp to uncover important information is essential to make progress. It's a laborious task at first, but you'll soon discover that making a break for it isn't just a matter of climbing over the fence and waiting till dark to sneak through a hole in the wall. Keys need to be stolen, disguises filched to make it past German patrols, crowbars obtained to break through locks, and Allied officers won over with acts of cunning and bravado. Every small task treads a very fine line between failure and success, so be prepared for a long, frustrating escape to victory. Seeing your plan develop solely through your own efforts is tremendously rewarding. Unfortunately, the difficulty of each task and the serious thought required to be successful is all too often ruined by the amateurish cutscenes and woeful attempts at humour. It just kills the whole atmosphere of the game.
Sleeping like babies. Gonna have to move real slow or I might wake them.
As much as you want to love this game for its attempt at something different, unfortunately, POW never feels like anything more than a preset series of stealthy tests. The overall experience veers from confusion, tedium, and frustration to intrigue, satisfaction, and exhilaration, and then back again throughout. It's still a uniquely rewarding experience and a true challenge, but one that requires an abundance of patience.
Glad you can make it.
I couldn't have you taking all the glory back at home.
We're not out of the woods yet. Better get comfortable. It's gonna be a long night.
Fights, all the drama, and all the over-the-top posturing. WWE SmackDown 4 Shut Your Mouth has it all. The new updated roster features even more world wrestling superstars, including Hollywood Hulk Hogan, Stacy Keibler, DDP, Ric Flair, and plenty of others. And if you want more, then there's also the improved Creator Wrestler system to provide you with a whole host of variations. And they all come with thousands of animations, including superstar signature moves and double and triple team moves. Come on, let's get it out.
The detailed story mode is even more exciting, offering multiple character paths, plenty of out-of-the-ring action, and for the first time, you get the chance to enter superstars into a world wrestling draft pool. The scenery has also been improved, with a range of backstage areas modelled after Madison Square Garden, and over 14 pay-per-view arenas, including Backlash, Vengeance, and Unforgiven. And the match types now include Elimination Tag, Captain Fall Tornado Six-Man Tag, and Slobber Knocker Anywhere, along with multiplayer options for six-player tag team, handicap and triple threat match variations. And to make life easier, the expanded partner system even allows you to control your tag team counterpart. Garnish that lot with TV-style in-game cutaway scenes, accurate play-by-play commentary, dynamic lighting effects and authentic superstar entrances, complete with full Titantron videos, and WWE SmackDown 4 Shut Your Mouth is a guaranteed knockout.
After the anticlimax that was Just Bring It, we were concerned by just what WWE SmackDown Shut Your Mouth might present us with. But as you can see, things are looking brighter from the word go. Since the last WWE release, there have been some serious reorganizations with the WWE, not least of which being the merger with WCW, which had the audacity to occur just after the shipping of the previous title. You can be sure that Shut Your Mouth is going to be as up-to-date as possible at its point of shipping, complete with all the current superstars, along with their allegiances and catchphrases, which should be great provided there are no more major upsets in the storylines. There's plenty more personality this time, with more complete settings, a 3D audience and commentary from JR and the King. The roster is probably the most comprehensive superstar list ever, with over 50 wrestlers present. And the creator wrestler system has also received an overhaul, so there's plenty more to play with, should you care to try. Obviously, the graphics have been on the right end of some serious attention, with the character models being much more detailed and the animations being personalized, with each wrestler's own distinctive style, rather than following some generic moves. One of the biggest criticisms of Just Bring It was the poor career mode, so this has received a major overhaul as well. It's now bigger and better than ever, with more out-of-ring events and more posturing and bravado than you could possibly ever want. There are over 14 pay-per-view arenas featuring the all-new SmackDown Raw and Heat sets, along with stages taken from Unforgiven, Vengeance, Backlash, and even the British spin-off Rebellion event. It's all looking very promising at the moment, with all the fine touches in place and the atmosphere being spot on. Now the only question remaining is whether they can... Calibur was generally considered to be one of the very best fighting games of its time, with a swath of innovative ideas and a varied cast of characters, each with their own distinctive style.
Ring out.
And with such a noble heritage, Soul Calibur 2 certainly has a lot to live up to. While there is a lot that will be familiar to fans of the original game, this sequel may not be quite as revolutionary as its predecessor, but it still brings its fair share of progress. The new innovations include an expanded arena design, with more varied shapes and partial enclosure around some stages. These walls can be used to stun opponents and as a means to outmaneuver the opposition.
I hardly broke a sweat.
The guard impact move has been simplified by two directions rather than the original four, and there's been significant expansion in the guard break attacks, although they still employ the familiar soul charge system. There are now three levels of charging, with only the highest level providing unblockable attacks, while the other two only produce counter hits. The story is the familiar search for the sword's soul edge. Destroyed by Shanghua at the end of the original game, fragments of the blade have appeared throughout the world, causing the majority of the cast to pick up the arms once again and rejoin the fray with all their varied motives. While Hu Wang and Sophie Xia both leave the stage due to their conclusive story arcs, there are four new characters joining the crew. Hong Yun-sung and Cassandra Alexandra neatly replace the two absentees, while the roguish nobleman Raphael Sorrel and the last priestess of the wind Talim each bring a new style to the mix. Bringing all the strengths of the original game, now powered by the might of the PS2 technology and streamlined for an even better fighting experience, Soul Calibur 2 looks set to win the hearts of fans and newcomers alike.
Forgive me!
Soul Calibur 2.
This classic arcade and Dreamcast fighting giant is making its way onto PS2, bringing with it all the features of the previous versions, backed up by the graphical prowess of PS2 hardware. Marvel vs. Capcom 2, New Age of Heroes, brings together over 50 characters from the Marvel comics and Capcom games. Although only 24 of them begin the game unlocked, amongst the stars you'll see the likes of Spider-Man, Captain America, and the X-Men, pitting their skills against such notables as Jill, Strider, and the crew from the Street Fighter games. There are various modes to compete in, including a full championship and player versus player competitions, with the 3-on-3 encounter being the most notable. Here you can have 6 characters involved at once, with the chance to use the Team Hyper Combo, where 3 characters perform super combos successfully, and the Crossover Combination, where 3 characters can perform super combos simultaneously. If that wasn't enough, the point system allows you to accumulate credits that can earn bonus abilities and unlock all sorts of new features, and there's plenty in here to find. It may have taken a while, but PS2 owners are finally going to get the chance to play this classic fighting game for themselves, and to decide once and for all whether Marvel or Capcom have the harder characters. While Tony Hawk still holds the benchmark for extreme sports games, there have been plenty of contenders for his crown, all featuring different twists on the same basic stunt-filled idea. Now entering the fray comes Kelly Slater's Pro Surfer, changing the playing field substantially and demanding that we get wet and wild. And who are we to refuse an offer like that? The main concern is probably the loss of the versatility and vibrancy from the urban settings, but since Treyarch has spent over a year getting the water to behave just right, you can rest assured that it is being suitably compensated for. With organic and random waves creating perfect recreations of those spectacular swells that Californians just take for granted. Every wave is unique, dramatically varying in height, speed, tubes and brakes. Even the waves in a single location vary from one run to the next, so there's no easy way out here. You can't just learn the course by rote. This time, you're really going to need some skill. The tricking itself remains true to the Tony Hawk system, although getting your specials meter up to full as quickly as possible is essential for success. Once you've got it maxed out, you can start to rack up some immense scores, and as long as you continue to land each trick perfectly, your combo will continue to multiply. And the icon challenge adds a further element, requiring you to perform the stunts indicated by the icons before the stack gets too tall. The ambience of this uniquely chilled sport has been impressively captured here, setting it in a different league from the competition. And while it may not be quite as technically brilliant as Tony Hawk 3, it is different enough to stand on its own. What a terrible thing for you to do. What an awful thing for you to say. What a terrible thing for you to confuse. What a terrible thing for you to do. What an awful thing for you to say. This game only made it as far as PC, but Hitman 2 Silent Assassin has made it to PS2, bringing its refreshing new approach to stealth killing. This isn't just Metal Gear Solid reheated. The aim here is not to mount an increasing body count, but to get the job done as efficiently and professionally as possible. Look smart, act smart. The game consists of a series of missions, each of which provide you with one or two targets, and they're all linked together by a fairly detailed story. Your laptop provides access to the mission information, along with the option to download maps, video footage of your targets, photos, and other useful info. Even with all this material, the missions are still very challenging, and you'll probably need to make several attempts before you're prepared for all the surprises. The downside of this is the extortionate loading times. On the upside, the missions are well designed and not every fumble is going to cost you the game. Mistakes make things harder, causing unnecessary deaths and forcing you to use less professional methods, but you can usually recover. However, the challenge is to pull off the hits as clinically and professionally as possible, and the ratings and statistics at the end of each mission only encourage such replay. So if you have any pride in doing the job well, you'll want to reload anyway. Each of the missions has a variety of ways to complete the hit. You can use disguises, sneak through back doors and windows, use non-lethal weapons, or just go for the gung-ho approach, should you be callous and unprofessional enough to gun down civilians. The whole thing generally looks fantastic, with only a few graphical glitches. Even the character models move perfectly, with some of the death sequences being very impressive. And when you consider the atmospheric ambient sounds, beefy weapons, and of course that sharp black suit, you know you're looking at a game with real style. JoJo's Bizarre Adventure definitely lives up to its name. On one side of the coin, it's an impressive recreation from the original manga, but on the other side, it's a basic action game. The cel-shaded graphics manage a remarkable recreation from the original artwork, and fans will recognize the speed lines, animating katakana, and the distinctive pacing, embodied in the various cutscenes and the slow motion sequences during the combat scenes. origins, there's no shortage of imagination in the design. But since this is set well after the original story, the cast has changed and the setting is now Italy, in the not-too-distant future. You take on the role of Giorno Giovanno, son of the earlier character Dio Brando, who's trying to get on with his business while being harassed by all manner of bizarre opponents. The combat sequences themselves are pretty straightforward, although things are spiced up with each character possessing a spirit alter ego called Stand, which grants them unusual powers in hand-to-hand combat. Giorno has an interesting range of moves here, although they can become a bit repetitive after a while. On the other hand, the various opponents to be faced each show a distinctive style, and just finding out what they're capable of can be quite entertaining, even if it does leave you spread thinly across the floor. Projecting your stand allows you to perform a range of new and interesting maneuvers, but also consumes its energy reserves. This reserve can be recharged by spending a little time on the defensive, which leads to the need to develop strategies for getting the most from your powers. While this certainly isn't going to be to everyone's taste, due to its bizarre nature and somewhat simplistic gameplay, fans of the manga are bound to love it. And the chance to unlock artwork as you defeat the opposition is just the icing on the cake. Lara's back, and Core have finally delivered her first PS2 adventure after months of worrying delay. Framed for the murder of her old mentor, Bon Croy, Lara's on the run while trying to find out the secret of the Cabal, an evil type intent on raising an ancient race of biblical crazies. Of course, this all translates into sneaking past guards, shimmying about to collect mystical items, and gunning down a variety of paranormal foes. Darkness will hopefully provide a more cerebral, adventure-based experience than before, and there are some all-new stealth elements to get excited about too. But can Lara conjure up the jaw-dropping magic of her first PS1 adventure? Our official hype-free verdict can be found on page 84 of this month's issue, sublimely complemented with this 6-minute exclusive video of Miss Croft doing her thing.